Greetings, Guardians. My name is Byfe here. Today I wanted to do something a little different, and I wanted to touch on the future. Destiny is at a weird place right now, and that's partly because of the vaulting of four planets, and it makes me wonder personally what future destinations we might be experiencing as a replacement. There is, of course, Europa and the return of the Cosmodrome, both of which are coming at some point in the next year. Europa obviously with Beyond Light, but for today I want to talk about some destinations that we've never seen before in Destiny that we might see one day in the future. Keep in mind that I'm not going to include anything that used to be in Destiny 1, such as the Ishtar Sink on Venus, or Meridian Bay on Mars, or the Dreadnought above Saturn. But I will be talking about a bunch of crazy potential future locations that are hinted at in the lore, or that might be future expansions based on the astronomy of our own solar system. So, with all of that said, before we start again, keep in mind that everything in here is speculative, and some of that will be very obvious, because some of this is based on small hints in the game, and other stuff is just wild and crazy. So, yeah, if none of this comes to pass, so be it. These are just potential ideas and places that Bungie could go, but might also elect to not go. So with all that being said, let's begin. And first off, let's actually start with the more obvious one, which is close to home. Yes, we're going to talk about Earth first, and whilst there are the locations of the EDZ and the Cosmodrome, Earth is a big place. During the Golden Age, there were a lot of different places that became loci of human advancement, and whilst there is no singular place that could possibly draw our focus, there are a lot of different noteworthy places that might stand out as future destinations. There is very early Destiny concept art of places, for example, like the jungles of the Mumbai Push, and there are whisperings from Lakshmi too about how the Fallen of the House of Devils burned Golden Age London to the ground. But I personally think the most likely destination might be the swamps of old Chicago, if only because it feels like it's a tiny bit more fleshed out than the other Earth destinations to date. That being said, the whole world exists with all of its different continents, and we could see all sorts of places. In previous Bungie games, for example, the continent of Africa was explored through Voi and New Mombasa in Halo, and we may get to explore there again in Destiny if Bungie elects to do so. And also, we have no idea of anything going on in Golden Age South America. It's an entire continent that is totally untapped that Bungie could explore. And what about the Arctic and Antarctic? For all we know, there may be colonies established there. Places which, of course, deal with the extreme cold, but might support at least some small amount of human life, if only for research purposes. All of that being said, Earth is Bungie's oyster. They could really take any destination they wanted and just run with it. Next up, I want to talk about a little Easter egg that might not be an Easter egg, but a real lore hint. Take a listen to this clip gathered from Titan.
Shipping manifests. Looks like they traded frequently with a settlement. Wow, way out there. It's called Hyperion.
Now, it's speculated that this voice line from the Riggs on Titan is a reference to the Hyperion Corporation in Borderlands, which might be true, but there's also some serendipitous lore that allows this to very much be a real possibility for another destination too. Hyperion is actually another one of Saturn's other smaller moons, which means that trade between it and Titan is not at all out of the question. Hyperion is unlikely to support breathable atmosphere, given its size, so it might have been similar to our moon as a destination. Think of an old mining colony, potentially invested by Fallen, or having uncovered a Vex artifact, or maybe with the Hive burrowing into everything as they tend to do. And you probably get the picture of what Hyperion might be if it's a destination that we could go to in the future. Next, we need to talk about the Iron Lords for a bit. And not because of Fellwinter's Peak or the Plaguelands, but because of Ephrodite and her story. After the Iron Lords fell, she was one of the two that survived alongside Lord Saladin, and from that point on, she took to treading a very different path. The grimoire card for Lady Ephrodite, as well as a few other lore details about her, contain information that hints towards the idea that there is a community of non-military guardians out in the deeper reaches of the system. Ephrodite has thus far refused to disclose the location of this community and its settlement, but at some point in the future, if this community wishes to have some kind of protection from invading forces, it might well mean that we could be needed to intervene. Needless to say, Ephrodite and the other guardians there are, well, guardians. They still have the power of the light, so defense might not be required. But the painting of them as non-military seems to point to the idea that we might be able to assist them in a time of need. Speaking of things that are absolutely military, though, let's go ahead and talk about the Hive. We saw the power of the Hive fleets back in the Taken King expansion when Oryx used his Dreadnought to completely smash the Awoken Ketches at the Queen's command. Here's the thing, though. What if I told you that there were entire planets infested by the Hive? Scary, right? Although not unheard of given what we've seen of our own moon. What if I then told you that the Hive burrowed into these planetoids to fortify them and make them even more defensible? Still pretty scary again, but you know, we have the moon, this is still nothing new. What if I told you though that they could take these planetoids and move them, and have them follow their fleets and provide a logistical base of operations for invasions into solar systems? Yeah, that's a thing called a war moon, and that is terrifying. These monstrosities are talked about in the Books of Sorrow, and if Luna is any indication of what to expect, we would probably see a whole bunch of these things being wielded by Savathun or Shivua Wrath. Whether they'll be a playable destination or not is up for debate. Whether we'll see them or not is a question that's up for debate too. Bungie might want to go ahead and take the tone of the Dreadnought or the Moon and just give it a bigger scale, turn it all the way up to 11, and create an entire Hive planet that is physically brought into the system. I could very much see them doing that if ever they involve Shivua Wrath, because, again, aspect of war, she seems like the kind of person to bring around a war moon. All of that being said, that's a potential future destination, and it's something that Bungie could imagine entirely on their own. It does not need any kind of reference for the real solar system that we have here, but with all of that said, it does still leave us with fascinating possibilities for future stories. Next, instead of talking about war moons, we're going to be talking about the biggest moon in our solar system, Ganymede. Ganymede is much bigger than any other body orbiting a planet in the solar system, including Saturn's largest moon of Titan. This makes it bigger than Mercury, bigger than our own moon, and in fact makes it the ninth largest object in the solar system. In fact, it's so large that it has enough gravitational force to pull on its fellow moon, Io. The force of it and Jupiter pulling on the other Galilean moon has helped contribute to Io's volcanic activity. All this aside, if humanity expanded into the Jovians as they did with Titan, there must have been a base of operations out at Jupiter, and Ganymede seems like a prime candidate. Not only because it's the largest planetoid in Jupiter's orbit, but also because it's just so freaking big. Personally, I don't know if there is any lore of settlements on Ganymede. I did a search and nothing came up. And it leaves an interesting question as to why, but it doesn't necessarily rule out the possibility. Jupiter's old grimoire card from Destiny 1 seems to imply that there must have been something out there, but that the possibilities are unknown, except for cities of ice and world-spanning oceans. Needless to say, this hints towards Europa, but it also, in my mind, leaves plenty of room for Ganymede to be a destination. And again, it's the largest object in the solar system. It's just sitting there, waiting. You know, this one really could be a big destination and we just don't know about it yet. Speaking of other objects that are orbiting Jupiter though, we need to talk about Europa and ice generally. I want to discuss something which could lead us to a destination that would freak me out generally, and yeah, it doesn't necessarily need to be on Europa either. There are moons out in our solar system that are much like Europa and are made at least partially of ice. Moons like, say, Callisto or Enceladus, for example. These moons won't just have an icy crust, but will also, in some cases, not have magma beneath their crust. This means, for one thing, that they're incredibly cold, but for another, it means that down beneath the ice planets like Callisto, an underwater world is waiting. In the last days on Kraken Mare lorebook, we see that scientists of the Arcology have the technology to use submersibles and to generally dive down into places close to the icy seafloor of Titan below its methane oceans. And so we know that the technology to get to these extreme places and survive in them exists. With all of that said, I can imagine something like an underwater research colony somewhere deep in the waters of Callisto, which would really, really, for me, be the worst place in the solar system. Why? There's no light down there, the water that surrounds you is constant, it's the only thing in every direction for miles and miles, and you have no idea what the hell might be out there in the water. If Titan is anything to go off of, there will be something big, there will be something hostile, and there will be something hungry. So, yeah, you can take a dip down there whenever you like, but I'll leave the thalassophobia to you, buddy, and I will keep both of my feet firmly planted on the ground. To move on to the next thing, I briefly mentioned a little old name there, which I know has got some of you perking your ears up at its mention, Enceladus. I still need to make a video talking about how I was wrong on this one, but to break it down really simply, no, the Deepstone Crypt is not an Enceladus, and I've helped perpetuate that particular myth. Yes, I'm sorry. That's on me. But with all of that said, Enceladus is still a destination that at some point we might be able to visit. What we also know about Enceladus, and why it might be a destination worth visiting, is because Cade left something for Petra in his notes, in his final records in the Ace of Spades quest. This is one of those interesting moments because it's something that's given in code and it's left specifically for Petra. What the particular thing Cade has left for Petra is also a complete mystery. It could be some kind of artifact related to the Awoken, it could just be one of Cade's stashes. It's really hard to tell, but regardless, it's possible that at some point in the future, either in a smaller or a larger capacity, we might visit Enceladus, and perhaps find out what Cade left for Petra there. Moving on from the Jovian ice moons and the hidden seas beneath them, we need to talk about an entirely different kind of sea, one that is very much a wild possibility, but a possibility nonetheless if Bungie creates some very interesting story shenanigans. It is simply the possibility that we might find ourselves venturing into the Sea of Screams. So what is the Sea of Screams? Well, between the ascendant realms of the Hive Gods, there is a sea of what is best described as paracausal energy within the ascendant realm. This is a sort of ocean between the islands of the throne worlds of the Hive Gods, and within it we'd probably be venturing through a whole lot of nothing, but with all that said, there are some interesting points that we could find. Mara Sov, for example, found Tolan's own attempt at creating an ascendant throne realm when she was wandering the Sea of Screams. There's also points at which you could link into other throne worlds of the Hive, and maybe you could even find a way to commune with those who have not spoken in a long time. Hive gods that we've never heard of or have always wished to witness could be found within the Ascendant Realm. This place is a place of pure dark energy, and the Hive craft their throne worlds with sword logic in between all of these spaces. But in the Sea of Screams, which for the most part is undefined, Bungie could let their imagination run wild. It really is a place that, for the most part, is left untouched by writing, and it is something that could be purely defined. There is a lot that we don't know about it, and if Bungie does decide to create some kind of interesting method of ingress, we might be able to see something really cool there. Again, accessing the Ascendant Realm is tough because there needs to be a method of ingress, but that is something that could be solved by a portal to a throne world. Or if Bungie is looking for something that connects just to the Sea of Screams, perhaps something more chaotic, something like a chasm that tears at the fabric between our realm and theirs. It's an interesting place to go, potentially, it's a crazy idea, but if Bungie does decide to make it a destination, I have no doubt that they will make it spectacular. For our penultimate location, we're going to talk about somewhere completely different to the terrible place that the Sea of Screams would be. We're going to talk about a place that was once paradise, and might still be, namely, the Distributory. The Distributory is the birthplace of the Awoken, a land imagined supposedly by the first queen of the Awoken, Alice Lee, but was really imagined and created by Mara Sov. This place was built upon the wishes and foundations of Mara's design, within a singularity that formed upon the terrible clash between light and dark. Mara and the crew of the Exodus Green were sucked into the Singularity and found themselves in a realm where they were immortal and were able to mostly live in peace, though Mara did plant the seeds of dissent in her people so that they might one day return to Sol. If we were ever to venture into the distributory, it is impossible to say what we'd find, and that's partly because of how time works in the distributory. You see, the distributory warps time, given that it's inside a singularity, and makes it pass far faster than it would in the typical Sol system's real space. The Awoken civilization existed within the distributory for untold millennia. Meanwhile, the collapse had barely ended, and the Dark Age had barely begun. That, of course, was the point at which Mara and her expedition left the distributory, but it did so after millions of years of potential growth and evolution. Which means that if we go back into the distributory, we may find a world that is now in perfect harmony, or we could see a world that is completely torn asunder by war and bloodshed. We could even find a barren husk where entropy has taken hold for millions of years. The reality is, we simply don't know. So much time has passed that the Awoken that still live within the distributory might not even remember who Mara and the other Awoken were. Their memory might have been erased. Then again, it is interesting given the state that Mara left that realm in, and there are many questions we still have to ask. If we are going to go there, at some point in the future, then it will undoubtedly be with the aid of Mara Sov and the Awoken. Finally though, I wanted to discuss a grim possibility, but one that we absolutely must address. The possibility of leaving our solar system for good. Needless to say, the Lightfall expansion in 2022 has everyone wondering what will become of Destiny. I don't think that it'll be the end of Destiny with Lightfall. I don't think this is the finishing of the fight. But I do think that it'll be the sort of second collapse that everyone is predicting. I think it's likely that it'll be the kind of cataclysmic event that Bungie will use to shake up the universe a bit. And I don't put the possibility of the city being destroyed out of the question, which means that our next destination, even social hub, could be in a different solar system entirely. But the scariest thing is what I'll leave you with. This future might have already been seen, in the Vault of Glass. A very old grimoire card from the Vault sees a ghost glimpsing into an unknown future timeline within the Vault's machinations, and in that timeline they see something terrible. The card in question is Mystery, the Vault of Glass 3, and it reads as follows. A starfield. The stars swing slowly across the ghost's field of view. Just darkness, and the blazing fury of distant suns as the ghost tumbles through empty space. Hours of this before, with a wash of power, a huge convoy of ships drops into reality from warp. A convoy of guardian craft, hundreds strong, ships of all sizes and shapes can be seen, from venerable craft that have been salvaged from the Golden Age, through to city designs, to vessels that have yet to emerge from the shipwright's hangars. The ships are battle-scarred. Many are barely space-worthy. As warp drives wind down, several seem to lose power and begin to drift. Some of the largest craft bear imagery familiar to frequent visitors to the tower. Dead orbit symbols, the simple icon of the Vanguard, the New Monarchy and future war cult as well, though fewer examples can be seen. Others bear symbols never seen in the tower to date. Every single ship, from the largest cruiser to the smallest personal craft, carries shards of stone, remnants of the city and the tower. Banners too, tattered and worn from entering and leaving warp. The fleet is only visible for a few breaths, less than a minute. Then, with a massive flash of light, the fleet jumps on. The craft that have lost power are left behind, spinning and whirling away from the etheric wake of their powered fellows. The ghost spins on, and soon enough, only stars fill its field of view, until the fragment ends. If this dark, defeated future awaits us out in space, I think it is possible that we might venture out to new stars, and to find new places where we might settle. And if we do, we may find a strange and unfamiliar set of worlds before us. But that is perhaps only if we lose. And that is all from me for now. I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, go ahead and leave a like. And if you want more kind of content like this, let me know in the comments section down below. I don't generally do lists of places, but in some instances I feel like it might be interesting to be able to pick at the remnants of what lore we have, and to simply piece together some interesting videos like this that might pique your curiosity in Destiny a little bit more. Who knows, maybe this video does really well and gets seen a whole bunch and invites new people into the Destiny fandom who might not necessarily know too much about it, but who might listen to some of this and be very interested. If you want more Destiny content as well, you can hit the subscribe button and the bell next to subscribe, but as per usual, know that your viewership as always is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.